Hello students, welcome to the BDP program. This program is for those students who are doing the BDP course and who have taken an option as translation in the third year. This course deals with the basics in translation, and today the expert with us is Dr. Anand Prakash from Delhi University, who will talk to you about translation theory and its practice. So, Dr. Anand Prakash, we would like to ask you, what is translation all about?
Well, friends, I have come here today to talk about translation, and the question asked is, what translation is about? So, what I say is that translation is a very useful exercise for people to communicate with those others who speak a different language. For instance, if we are in India and we want to make our writing or our views available to people who use another language, then translation is the means through which one can do it. In that case, it is very essential to have a kind of link, whether the link is intellectual or the link is cultural, with people of other languages. So translation has to be done from one language to another. It can be, the other language can be in the same country, or it can be of another country, which means that through translation we can reach out not merely to the people in our own country, but also to people elsewhere in the world. We have to keep in mind that even though the language is different of the person who translates, he translates from one language to another. Even then, the question arises whether we are translating a language into another language. And we have to consider whether this is the case. And I say that no, we don't translate a language into another language. What we do is that there is a text written in a language, and that text is to be conveyed in its fullness, to the extent to that it is possible, into another language. So we present a text of a language to speakers of another language, and when we do that, then those other speakers of the other language, they create a text of their own with the help of what the translator has done in one's own case. So yes, we translate the text but not the language. Yet I would like to raise a theoretical question here, whether what we translate is a text. Well, obviously we translate text, but we do more than that, and the translator has to keep track of not merely the text but also the person who wrote the text. Now there are lots of debates about it, whether we should be aware of the person who produced the text, and some people say that no, we should just communicate the text into another language. But those who believe that, and I am one of them, those who believe that a text is to be translated keeping in mind the person who wrote it, would say that before one translates a text, one should be fully aware of the sensitivity and the sensibility of the person who produced it, and secondly of the time in which the text was produced. Now the text may contain some elements of the time, but only very invisibly. But when the translator has to translate a text, then he or she has to be aware of the time, of the conditions in which the text was produced. So this is a theoretical question. Yes, we translate the text, and at the same time we keep in mind the time when the text was produced, and by a person who was of a specific sensibility. The second thing regarding this person who produced the text that is to be kept in mind is that this person was communicating one's meaning to an audience, which was a specific audience. And at the same time, this person was confronted with a large number of cultural questions, and he or she had a stand on these questions. And in fact, the sum total of these questions and of these strains, etc., was behind the production of the text. So yes, translation is a very serious job, it's a very responsible job, and it can be done only when apart from the knowledge of the text, one also has the knowledge of the person who produced the text and of the times in which the text was produced. So that's how I think translation has to bear the strain and the burden of these considerations. So this is what translation is about.
Can I interrupt you?
Yes.
I just wanted to know if it's essential for a translator to be fluent in both the languages when he's translating a text.
Well, yes, that's a good question, in the sense, you know, that when one translates a text, one fully understands the meaning of the text in the original language, but the other language, the target audience speaks, there the mastery is much more important, because there you are creating the text again through another language. So if one is slightly wanting in the use of the other language, the target for which the target audience uses, then of course the translation will be bad. Because particularly in literature, because we are today taking the example of a literary text, translation also becomes a very creative and experimentative activity. And for that, you know, the knowledge of the other language into which the text is to be rendered, that is very essential. So I would say Mrinda that. And,
okay. So you can proceed with your...
Okay. From this point, I would like to... from this theoretical point, I would like now to tell you regarding a particular text that one should be able to translate, keeping these things in mind, which I have so far shared with you. I have picked up at random today a text from Hindi, and I would like to apply some of the things that I have shared with you to this text and to this author, so that, you know, I'm able to explain what exactly I mean by translating effectively a text into another language. The author I have chosen for discussion today in the context of translation is the famous Hindi poet and prose writer called Subhadra Kumari Chauhan. This lady, very important literary figure in the national movement, as all of you would have heard, was known for her rendering of the passions of the 1857 uprising in her famous poem called Khoob Ladi Mardani Wo To Jhansi Wali Rani Thi. So this is the person who also wrote short stories, and I picked up a short story by her for discussion today. Now, before I talk about the story that she wrote, let me tell you that in order to understand the story, one should understand this person and her views on the national movement and on the Indian society. Because without that, it will be a bit difficult to interpret for one's own use the meaning of the short story that we discuss. Subhadra Kumari Chauhan was a very important literary figure and an intellectual figure in the Indian national movement. She participated in the movement at different levels. She was very close to the Congress party, in which the most prominent figure was Mahatma Gandhi. And she was a great admirer of Mahatma Gandhi and felt inspired to do what Gandhiji would like writers, etc., to perform as their role. which means that she was of a secular bent of mind. She wanted to understand the society as objectively as possible, and then she would share the nationalist, anti-imperialist message with the audience, with the readers for whom she wrote, which is quite clear from the poem that I have already mentioned. It was interesting to read, you know, something about something by her in the Hindi prose, and very few, of course, would have heard that she also wrote a large number of short stories. And now, of course, the short stories are available at a bigger level, and National Book Trust has itself produced a book of short stories by her. And she was writing stories, and she was writing stories not to express herself, not to share her own pain and her own suffering, etc., as the contemporary writers do. She was spreading kind of a message through her short stories among the audience, among the readers, and from that purpose she wrote. With that purpose she wrote. So when she was writing short stories, then she was sharing some of the concerns of the larger public whom she had to mobilize along with many others for the anti-imperialist struggle during the national movement. So when we know that she was a part of the national movement and that she was a radical voice in Hindi literature, then the same story has to be understood slightly differently. The story I have chosen is called Biaha. Now, Biaha is a colloquial word in Hindi. And of course, it has something to do with Biah or marriage. But what is Biaha? As we read the story, we realize that it's about a girl who has been married, and she has been married to a person whom she has never seen. But she says that the person she was married to was her Biaha, which means that we have to interpret this word as Biaha, which means the husband. Can we translate the word Biaha as the husband? This is what I thought I will do. So initially the story would have to be, in my opinion, with the title Biaha, the husband. But when I read the story and when I reread it and when I started thinking about the concerns of this author, then I realized that the woman had no role to play in her own marriage. She was not a woman at that time. She was hardly 6 or 7 years. And when the narrator of the story meets this girl, whom she considers a boy from a distance, because she doesn't know whether it's a boy or a girl. The girl is only 8 years, and she's already married, and she cannot communicate properly in a sophisticated language, because she comes from the common masses. She doesn't have any money on her. She doesn't have any clothes on her, except a little shawl, you know, which is tattered, which is completely worn out, and she doesn't even know that she has to cover her body. And she doesn't know her husband. So in that case, what does Biaha mean for her? She doesn't even know the meaning of the husband. She has only heard that she was married to a person. So I had a problem. And when I knew that the writer was showing full sympathy for the woman, then I realized that the title of the story would not be the husband. It has to be then something else. Because the kind of situation in which she finds herself or in which she is placed by the author shows that the woman is completely unaware of the situation that she is faced with. So I finally translated the title of the story not as the husband, but as one she was married to, the one she was married to, which might have so many meanings for the audience. And when today the English knowing person reads the story and the title is given as the one she was married to, then one would be wondering as to what exactly is meant. And this struggle to understand the meaning behind the one she was married to, this struggle will make this story very meaningful for the audience, because this is what the writer wants to say. The girl doesn't know that she is married. She doesn't know what husband is. She is in search of the husband. The husband has left. And how will she search for the husband? So story that talks about the search of the husband by a woman, and the woman doesn't know that this is what a husband is. So the whole question, with all the irony around it, can be communicated with five words in the title, the one she was married to. Now, as we translate the story, we have to keep in mind also the fact that there are two kinds of worlds that this story communicates. For instance, there is a world that the narrator belongs to. The narrator is a middle-class woman, educated woman. The narrator is a poet, like the author herself, and she is going to Jabalpur, where she will attend a conference. She is going to perhaps Azamgarh, and she is going to attend a poetry conference there, and she will perhaps recite her poems. And she is traveling by train, and she is sitting in the intermediate class, all-women compartment. And on that particular day when she is traveling, then she is all alone in the compartment, and she feels very lonely. And then at the next station, when this train stops, then she realizes that somebody is bringing a girl along from a distance. One can't even tell whether it's a girl or a boy, and the girl would be hardly 7 or 8 years. And this is the person she'll be facing in the compartment for the rest of the journey, that the girl will be with her. So the narrator has one world where she has a daughter, and generally she travels with that daughter, but today she is alone, and then she has a daughter-like figure in the form of Biaha. So that's how one has to keep in mind that there are two levels. One, the level of the author, the narrator, who is a middle class educated person, and the other is the level of the young girl who is totally unaware about the surroundings and who has only to search for a husband somewhere in this wide vast world. Will she be able to search for a husband? And she carries a plate and she carries a small glass and a small cup, all made of brass, etc. And she is carrying this may be her only way to show her kind of dowry. Maybe her parents gave the glass and the plates, etc., for her to carry on her business as a wife. So she is carrying it as a very precious thing in her hands, and she enters the compartment and she is with the narrator. So straight away, the writer is trying to convey to us that in India, there are two kinds of people: the sensitive ones, the ones who can use the language, the ones who can observe, and the vast majority of the people who don't know where they are, to whom they belong, whether they'll be able to reach their goal, etc., or not. And this gap seems to be, in my opinion, content of the story. And this is to be conveyed like this. So with this kind of background, where will this girl go? Who will drop her there, etc., are the questions that are always open. And the person who helps the girl enter the compartment, this person requests the narrator to ask her to get down at Allahabad, where the girl has heard that her husband has gone, and she'll search for him there. So this is how the story begins. And after giving the idea of the story and the idea of the narrator and the idea of the author, the kind of thing that the author wanted to share with the audience, then I get down to the brass tacks of the translation. This is how the story begins, and let's see whether we face problems concerning communicating the meaning in its entirety, the way I have interpreted the story. And I repeat for the benefit of our friends that the story has to be understood in its entirety, in the context of the author, in the context of his or her sensibility, and the times in which the story was produced. And then let's see how the story begins in Hindi. So I first read in Hindi and then I render it in English, and wherever I find some problems, there I will discuss those problems point by point. This is how the story begins in Hindi. Jabalpur se Azamgarh. डोढ़े दर्जे का जनाना डब्बा और पूरे डब्बे में अकेली मैं. आई एम ट्रांसलेटिंग इट एज आई एम ट्रेवलिंग फ्रॉम जबलपुर टू आजमगढ़ बाई ट्रेन इन द इंटरमीडिएट क्लास ऑल वुमेन्स कंपार्टमेंट द बिग कंपार्टमेंट एंड मी अलोन. डाक गाड़ी हवा में उड़ती जा रही थी और मेरे दिमाग में रह रहकर एक ही बात चक्कर काट रही थी कि जब जब मैं बच्ची को लेकर चलती हूँ तो डब्बे में तिल रखने की जगह नहीं होती, और आज जब मैं बिल्कुल अकेली हूं तो डब्बे भर में यात्रा करने वाली एक भी स्त्री नहीं. जस्ट कंसीडर वन थिंग वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग रिगार्डिंग द सेकंड सेंटेंस इन द हिंदी टेक्स्ट. द सेंटेंस बिगिंस विद डाक गाड़ी हवा में उड़ती जा रही थी, विच इज द पास्ट टेंस. व्हेन द सेंटेंस एंड्स एंड इन द मिडल ऑल्सो, जब मैं बच्ची को लेकर चलती हूँ डब्बे में तिल रखने की जगह नहीं होती और आज जब मैं बिल्कुल अकेली हूँ तो डब्बे भर में यात्रा करने वाले एक भी स्त्री नहीं. इट इज वेरी नेचुरली शिफ्टेड टू द प्रेजेंट टेंस. नाउ इन द हिंदी प्रोज दिस काइंड ऑफ थिंग इज क्वाइट नेचुरल. व्हेन वी टेल द स्टोरी देन वी आर नॉट जनरली अवेयर ऑफ द पास्ट और द प्रेजेंट टेंस, बिकॉज वी आर इन द स्टोरी मोड. पर्टिकुलरली वी आर टेलिंग द स्टोरी टू समबडी एंड वी कैन नेचुरली शिफ्ट फ्रॉम वन टेंस टू अनदर. इन इंग्लिश द स्टोरी मोड इज मेनली फॉर प्रिंटिंग. Is not meant for telling the story to an audience who may or may not have the text available in print. Therefore, Subhadra Kumari Chauhan is writing for a reader who may hear the story read by somebody else, and at the same time, it is meant for reading so far as we are concerned.
Also, add that the sentence is very long, and if you translate in English, I think you'll have to make it into one or two sentences, or can you translate it into a single sentence like it is in English, in Hindi?
Well, that's quite useful to consider, Mridula, because sometimes, the long sentence has to be split into two or three short sentences, and the flow is to be kept intact. Because, the flow of a long sentence in Hindi may not be exactly conveyed into the long sentence in English. Mm. And if the long sentence comes in the way of the flow, then there's no harm in And in fact, in the literary translation, one has to keep in mind that the flow should be communicated in whatever way. If the flow can be communicated in short sentences, fine. If it can't be, and if the long sentence is good enough, then one should use the long sentence. So there are no hard and fast rules regarding this. And I, for one, would say that, yes, the long sentence in Hindi can be split into two or three short sentences, which I have done already in the first case.
Okay.
Because pure dabbe mein akeli mein, I put it in the second sentence. Okay, let's see how I render it into English. The mail train is moving really fast. So I already, instead of saying ja rahi thi, I said ja rahi hai. The mail train is moving really fast and only one thing is troubling me at the moment. And then I put a dash and then I explain, whenever I am accompanied by my young daughter, the compartment is packed to capacity. Whereas today, when I came alone, there is no second person to look at. So I have kept the sentence in the present tense throughout its length, because that's how the target language is written these days, and it's meant to be read in print. So this is another question that we have to keep in mind, whether the tense is to be the same. I think we can experiment with the tense and keep the flow intact. The last sentence in this description is, साथ में ना तो कोई पुस्तक थी और ना अखबार. This is quite precise and a short sentence, and this doesn't offer any problem. I translate it in the informal style, nor am I carrying a book or newspaper to read. I have tried to consider one more thing, that since the narrator is talking to oneself, so the tone has to be completely informal. Because when you are with yourself, then you don't bother about the correct or the incorrect use of words. And in any case, the words have to be as simple as possible. Therefore, in fact, this is a half sentence. Nor am I carrying a book or newspaper to read. And then, mujhe akelapan akharne laga. Gradually, the lonely feeling became unbearable. Here I shift to the past tense, because this way, within the present, there is a slight shift. And after some time, it became unbearable. You can't say it becomes unbearable, because after all you have to tell the story that happened sometime in the past. Now this is how the story begins, and you can see that in a short story, unlike any other form of literary writing, a context has to be immediately constructed, and the context is created by referring to the journey that is beginning in the middle of which the journey has been described by the author, because something very important is going to happen a bit later. Now after a few paragraphs, the person is introduced about whom this is the story. The person whose biyaha is somewhere in the world, and for whom this girl is moving to and fro. मैंने पूछा, ये बच्ची है किसकी? ये तो मैं नहीं जानता, कांस्टेबल ने कहा, पर इसे इलाहाबाद जाना जरूरी है, कई दिनों से कह रही है और गाड़ी के पास दौड़ कर आती है. Now let's see how this is to be rendered into English. Because this is a dialogue, earlier it was a description, and the dialogue is also in half sentences, because that's how dialogues are, and the context is very crisp. Somebody is taking the child along and introducing the child to the narrator who is in the train, and the narrator asks, I inquired, who are the parents of this girl? Can't tell, said the constable, but she must reach Allahabad. For many days, she has been insisting to go there and comes running to the train whenever she spots one on the platform. So I knew that, you know, in the Hindi text, the author was not making long sentences and with short, you know, telegraphic sentences. You know, that you just speak a few words and the whole meaning is clear. That's the style that was used by the author. So I thought that should be retained in the translation also. And with the help of the half sentences, one was able to do it. Maybe it can be improved further, but I thought that these short sentences would do the trick here and will keep, will convey the intensity of the moment through them a bit better. Now let's see that on the next page of the story. It's a very short story in length. It's just 4 pages or so in the printed form. And very soon, a kind of curiosity will emerge in the mind of the narrator, and she would like to know more about the girl from the girl herself. How will she do it? Let's see this process. And I take the next snippet from the Hindi text. मैं उठकर उसके पास गई, उसके करीब ही बैठकर पूछा, तुम्हारा नाम क्या है? I took a step towards her and sat close by. करीब बैठकर पूछा, I just asked, I'm going to use in the second sentence, but here sat close by, and this I thought was essential to for me to you know, find out in the sense, you know, that the narrator goes and sits, and then there's a gap, and why does she sit there? I thought at that point of time, a full stop was needed, so that the reader is made to wonder as to why she's sitting there. And immediately after that, I asked, what's your name? And she says, Ram Pyari. She answered without looking towards me. In Hindi it is, Ram Pyari. Meri taraf bina dekhe hi usne jawab diya. Aur tum kahan ja rahi ho? And she says, Allahabad. And where are you going? And then the narrator asked the question, Allahabad mein kiske paas jaogi? Maine phir poocha, to whom in Allahabad? I extended the question. Aur is baar sir uthakar meri taraf dekhte hue usne kaha, apne biyah ke paas jait lag hai. Now see the new challenge that is coming for the translator. Now this is not Hindi, this is a dialect of Hindi, and this must be the Hindi that is spoken somewhere near Azamgarh or Jabalpur. And the girl is coming from a village, and I could not use a dialect of English here, because that would create problems for the translator and for the audience. Which dialect should one use? And of course, the equivalent of Allahabad or Jabalpur or Azamgarh for the English reader would be completely lost. So I thought I should just dilute it in terms of grammar, and I'll make it a little more fluent. Let's see whether I've succeeded in doing so or not. And this time, she raised her head and looked in my direction to tell she was going to join one she was married to. So this is where the title becomes clear. And she also is not calling him her husband, but she is calling in the Hindi text, Biyaha, apne biyaha ke paas jait lag hai. And I thought that the kind of uncertainty that is there in jait lag hai, I would convey through to tell she was going to join one she was married to. So this way, this problem has been circumvented, and of course, the dialect cannot be rendered into a dialect of English. So I thought that if one made it a bit more spoken, then perhaps one can achieve more or less a similar effect, if not the same effect. Let me tell you that in the act of translating a literary text, it is very important to see that the two languages belong to two different cultures. Hindi has one kind of a culture, and English has a totally different kind of a culture. And it is a tough job for the translator to find an equivalent of the situation in a Hindi region, equivalent for this in the language of another country or another society. So this equivalence is one of the greatest difficulties in the act of translation, and one is to keep totally stuck to this kind of a thing throughout the act of translation. Then I take the ending of the story in Hindi, and let's see whether I'm able to render this into English with that effect, which is nearly that effect, which is earned by or created by the original writer. This is how the story ends. मैं सोच रही थी कि मैं सांसारिक बंधनों से और अभी तो आजमगढ़ के कवि सम्मेलन से न बंधी होती तो राम प्यारे के पीछे पीछे जाती, देखती वो अपने ब्याह को कैसे खोजती है. See, once again, it's a long sentence. मैं सोच रही थी सांसारिक बंधन, and after that there's a break, और अभी तो सोच रही थी in general, सोच रही थी in the long term, but certainly at the moment I'm thinking of this. And this kind of break in the sentence at the end is really very, very effective, because this totally takes the audience into its grip. And one can, you know, say that in the long term and in the short term. Let's see whether in English this makes sense. I pondered, if I were free from worldly bonds, which is a larger context, and particularly at this moment, not obliged to attend the poetry conference at Azamgarh, I would follow Rampyari unnoticed and see how she searched for the one she was married to. So she, the narrator wants to find out through this search whether the girl would move around and ask people, or whether finally she would reach her goal. And then the author says to herself, ah, ye anveshan kitna sundar hota. You see that even the original author is not in full control of the language that one is using. Because, you know, when we use our own language as our first language, even there we are struggling all the time. So, let's not say that, you know, the original writer is in full control of the language. Because in the original language, a kind of struggle occurs between one's intention and the available vocabulary or available language. For instance, here, ah, ye anveshan kitna sundar hota. This anveshan, what does it convey? Anveshan means invention. In Hindi, that's the standard translation of the word anveshan. But here the word is not anveshan. Here the word is search. And then the search is very simple. The search is that the girl is going around, and finally she may or may not, in fact, it's impossible for the young girl to find the husband in Allahabad. She doesn't know his name, she doesn't know how he looks like, she doesn't know the place he might be found at, and Allahabad is a big place, and she's coming from a village, and she cannot communicate in any other language except a dialect. So, but there's a possibility that finally she'll reach her husband. And when she reaches her husband, will it be an invention? Invention means make something that was not there existing earlier, or will it be a search? So the author tried to convey this idea through anveshan, and what exactly anveshan meant to her in the process of struggling to convey this meaning. But anyway, let's see how this can be sorted out in the translated version. Ah, ye anveshan kitna sundar hota, and I have done it, good God. How fascinating would that search be? Now the word sundar is beautiful, and of course the word beautiful is quite will also suit this particular occasion. But I thought that because the author, narrator, is herself a poet, and the poet visualizes lots of things, so the sundar, which is only to the eye, will not convey the idea of the happiness and of the beauty that the author will feel or will visualize. So I thought fascinating will be a better word. And once again the exclamation, one wonders, and at the same time there's a sense of pain. And I thought that perhaps a bit of helplessness in the tone of the narrator as she was expressing herself would be somewhat useful. So I said, good God, which explains helplessness as well as wonder, and then how fascinating would that search be. The last sentence in the story, in the text, is parab to reh reh kar ek hi prashn uth raha tha jo abhi bhi anuttarit hi hai uska vyah use mila bhi ya nahi. Now just see that this last sentence in the story is very academic in its use of English, in its use of Hindi. It's using tatsam words, Sanskrit words, and these words don't gel with the theme of the story. But then the author is conscious that she's a poet, and as a poet she uses this as a specialized language, as a specialized vocabulary to convey her meaning. And therefore she is creating consciously perhaps a gap between the character about whom she is talking and about herself, you know, who is responding to the needs of that character. So prashan and anuttarit, and then vyaha. See the gap. Prashan and anuttarit, both are Sanskrit words, Sanskrit tatsam words. It could be sawal also, iska jawab nahi mila, it could be that also, and vyaha. But then the gap wouldn't have been created the way the original writer perhaps intended to create. In English, I thought a bit of formality will do, a formal tone will do, and that's what I tried to attempt in the translation. I read the Hindi again, and then immediately after that the English one. पर अब तो रह रहकर एक ही प्रश्न उठ रहा था जो अभी भी अनुत्तरित ही है, उसका ब्याह उसे मिला भी या नहीं. बट इन द प्रेजेंट केस ओनली दिस क्वेश्चन हॉन्टेड मी एंड टू विच एन आंसर इज येट टू बी फाउंड वेदर शी वॉज एबल टू ज्वाइन द वन शी वॉज मैरिड टू. यू सी आई फाउंड व्हाइल कंपोजिंग दिस सेंटेंस दैट आई हैड टू स्टिक टू द वर्ड टू द फ्रेज द वन शी वॉज मैरिड टू अगेन एंड अगेन. Because the word Biaha is used by the author as a constant refrain. And I ended the story with the same word that occurs at the end of the original story. Uska Biaha Use Mila Bhi Ya Nahi. So this way, I thought that the question, haunted, in the present case, etc., they are sophisticated things. You say in the present case only when you are able to talk about the present moment and separate it from what has occurred earlier. So this I thought was one way to convey the meaning of the poem. Now
the second last sentence, you know, just was there. It says, "ऐसा लगा कि युग युग से कोई अज्ञात वाणी जिसे सीता और सावित्री कहते हैं, उस बच्ची के कंठ से प्रतिध्वनित हो रही थी." I was wondering how like the people in the target language would they, how would you explain to them Sita and Savitri? Would you put a footnote saying like who they were?
Yes, I think that would be used, and this question I didn't want to go into because because the level of the students, they are undergraduates. Mm-hmm. But yes, this is the question that is to be kept in mind, that whenever there are mythical references, mm-hmm. then those mythical references have to be explained in the footnotes. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, the English-knowing audience, of course, in India, all English-knowing audience would understand the words that you refer to. But if the short story is read by a non-Indian English-knowing reader, then, of course, footnotes would be necessary. And since English is accessible to people from all corners of the world, therefore, footnotes regarding Sita and others will be once again quite useful. The second question regarding this is that this also will increase the scope of this is the cultural kind of equivalence which is very difficult to find. Now one could think of certain figures which stand for the same values that Sita and Savitri stand, but all languages may not have such figures. And why should one unnecessarily bring in those figures, because they have their different contexts.
And so again, how do you translate Aarti ki mudra when in the second last paragraph? I was just wondering, I wanted to...
No, she is, I think, I would... Aarti ki mudra is a religious kind of a gesture. Mm-hmm. Because the idea of the author is not to touch upon the religious aspect, but saying that she is respectfully holding cup and the glass in the plate, and in the pose of a person who is offering prayers. Mm-hmm. So this is what the idea is. So I think respectfully holding in front of her would do the job.
Yes.
And when you explain in the footnotes that it has some religious connotation of offering worship, etc., then the whole thing can be created.
Yeah.
But you are right. The translation has to be open-ended, and it depends on how you interpret the story.
Mm.
If the author is also presenting religion and tradition and morality ironically, because religion has sanctioned this marriage, tradition has sanctioned this marriage, this girl is now married for all time to come to a person she doesn't know. So even religion comes under some kind of a scanner. So this irony can be conveyed, and the author, because she was a part of the national movement, and religious reform was one of the very strong components of the national movement, so the author was able to create this kind of a dichotomy and make it a kind of a question to be sorted out by the audience. So yes, this is correct. These figures will have to be interpreted partly through the story and partly at the level of the readers who are going to read the story. Mm-hmm. So this will remain an open question, and I believe that the story that way can convey a certain meaning and at the same time can also create a sense of dialogue,
mm-hmm.
a kind of, you know, divided attention,
mm-hmm.
that is to be paid, where the reader will read the story, will think about it more, and maybe sometimes even ask questions regarding the enormity of the situation. You know, where the girl where would she go? Who will feed her? Will she get a job somewhere? Can she communicate herself? Will she be lost on the way, not to be found? And in fact, in the story, as you rightly pointed out, that there are references to mythology,
mm-hmm.
in the middle of the story, there are also references to the symbol of this girl. This girl is not a girl alone.
Mm-hmm.
This girl is the larger illiterate masses in the country who have nobody to fall back on and who have to fend for themselves. And will they be able to reach their goal? So the writer is, of course, talking about this figure of a girl, but at a larger level, at a different level, she's also talking about those illiterate masses who have no support from anywhere, from the system, etc., and who are facing starvation and misery all along in their lives, and whether they'll be able to make do with the world in which they are born or not is the question that mm-hmm. the reader has to face and work to in order to reach a proper understanding of the story.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how it is.
No, like we have seen how one translates a prose piece. Now, is translating a drama different from how you translate prose?
Yes, because you know this short story mode uses the formal and the informal.
Mm-hmm.
In the description, it has to be formal. When the author, for instance, here the narrator is talking, then she's talking in her language.
Mm-hmm.
And when the character is made to speak, then the language undergoes a total change.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this kind of a thing is not found in drama. Mm-hmm. In drama, there are characters and they speak their own lines.
Mm-hmm.
And they speak in their own particular register, in their own particular kind of language. But here the author is communicating directly certain things, and that is author's language.
Mm-hmm.
And the dialogues are simpler. So, mm-hmm. in a short story, one has to keep a balance between the language of the author, which is formal,
mm-hmm.
which is descriptive, which is explanatory, and the dialogues, which are crisp and which suggest a large number of things, but do not convey them directly or elaborately. So yes, doing a short story into another language is one kind of practice, totally different from doing a play into another language. There one has to use the dialogue form and has to perhaps use the tone more than the explanation, as is the case with the short story.
Mm-hmm. And of course poetry is totally different, right? One has to keep different other things in mind other than what we...
Yes, I think poetry is a totally different discipline, because you know there most of the things remain unsaid, mm-hmm. and things are suggested, and
mm-hmm.
sometimes they are suggested not through words,
mm-hmm.
but through that arrangement which also is governed to some extent by music, by harmony, by rhythm, by suggestion.
Mm-hmm.
So poetry is much more creative.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, sometimes when one translates a poem,
mm-hmm.
One may more or less totally forget the words that were there in the original,
mm-hmm.
because then the person is keeping in mind the consciousness and the knowledge of the language of the target audience,
mm-hmm.
and their poetry that way, even the translation is going to be more inventive,
mm-hmm.
and for that reason open to debate,
yeah.
because some you know critic will catch the translator saying that one has taken liberties with the original text, and that one has written a different kind of a text in the target language.
Mm. So I hope our students have benefited a lot from today's program, and they have learned how a person goes about while translating a short story, and how translating a short story is different from translating drama and translating a poem. So thank you, Dr. Anand Prakash, for enlightening our students, and I hope the students will have learned a lot from today's program.
Thanks, Mridula, and I hope that students should be able to see some points here which have been raised by me, and that they'll think further along these lines. Thanks, Mridula, again.